We've been worshiping now about 50 minutes. And I don't know if you know this or not, I'm not trying to be morbid, but just to put some things in perspective, in the 50 minutes that we have been worshiping in America alone, 250 people have died. And when we think in terms of that, as believers, we think in terms of, wonder if they were saved. Wonder how many of those 250 knew Jesus. Sometimes I'll think about that kind of question when I go into places like last year I went to see the Dolphins play at Hard Rock Stadium, and I'm looking at this crowd. I wonder how many of these people would go to heaven if Jesus were to come back right now. Wonder how many of these people around me know the Lord. Maybe you're at a birthday party and you wonder that, or you're at work and you're walking through the halls and you wonder that. Wonder how many of these people know Jesus. There are times in our lives when things happen in such a way that bring that right in front of your face. And this morning, just as we were praying, the Lord gave me permission to share something that happened to me that's appropriate for this. It's not something I share a lot because I just don't go around telling everybody this, but about 2 years ago, I guess it was, after a service, when we were over at the school, we had a baptism one morning, and Danny and I were taking the baptismal stuff back to the office. At that time, we kept all that stuff kind of behind the church offices downtown. And so we were unloading, you know, the baptismal pool, the hoses, all the different things that we had. And it was hot. And I'm a North Carolina boy, and I'm still getting used to the heat. And so we're out there working. And it was also during a time where I was doing intermittent fasting. So I had not eaten anything. It was that morning. I guess it was, well, it was right after church. So it was like 12:30, 1 o'clock. I had not eaten anything since like 6 p.m. the previous night. And so I'm out in that heat just getting it, you know. And I start feeling kind of, you know, I'm not feeling so hot, but let's get this done, you know. We guys are. So I just kept pushing it. And then as we finished, and I slowed down a little bit, then I felt even worse. Well, if I just get to my truck, I'll turn on the air, I'll just sit there a minute, I'll be fine. I get to the door of the truck, and I thought, I ain't going to be fine. This isn't good. And I turned to Danny, and I said, Danny, and that's the last thing I remember. And I went down. When I came to in a different position than I went down. When I went down, I was beside my truck. When I came to, I was near the life room door. And what had happened was, is Carrie and Fran were driving behind the offices around the same time, and Carrie happened to see me go down, and they turned in. And so Danny and Carrie are working with me, trying to get me back into this world. And so when I come to, I am seated on my bottom, my back leaning against Carrie's knees, and Carrie is, like, I'm right here, and Carrie's behind me, and he is slapping the fire out of my face. Quack, quack. It's like, you know, getting slapped by a catcher's mitt, you know? I mean, his hands, and I came to, and he said, dude, you scared me to death. I said, what happened? He said, you went down, we pulled you over here, we called 911, said, don't get up. Danny was walking out with some Sprite, and he got me to, you know, try to give me something to drink. And he said, what happened? I said, well, I just passed out, I guess, in this heat or whatever, and I was working and stuff. I hadn't eaten since yesterday and that kind of thing. And I said, but you know what was crazy? I saw something while I was out. And what I saw was, I said, it's really interesting because, you know, you always hear that your life flashes before your eyes. And it genuinely did. What happened was, I'm sitting there all of a sudden I'm seeing things from my childhood up through teenage years, and they're just coming one right after the other. And they're coming so quickly that I can't really make them out. I want to enjoy them. You know, I want to watch, you know. And they're coming so fast, it's almost a little frightening how fast they're coming. I didn't know what was going on. And so the only thing I knew to do in those moments was, in my mind, I put my hands up and I yelled, "Lord, please make it stop." And he said, "Yes, you did yell." And he said, "No, you didn't put your hands up, but I heard you yell." And he said, "It was a guttural yell that scared me to death." I'm thinking, well, man, as big as Carrie gets scared to death, that must be quite a yell, you know. But he said, "No, that was..." He said, "I thought you were gone." He said, "Your lips were turning purple." He said, "I thought we're going to leave them right here." What happened, though, was when I yelled, "Lord, please make it stop," all of a sudden, it stopped. And all I could see was a grassy pasture and a little lamb looking at me. And I had such peace. And then I came to. Well, I was like, wow, that's quite something to see, you know. And I'm, "Lord, what does that mean?" And I thought, well, you know, Jesus is depicted as the Lamb of God. So maybe what I'm seeing is a symbolism of Christ. The Christ is with me. When we were in Israel, I was talking to our guide, and he and I were sharing all kinds of stuff one day. And we had some time, and we were visiting together in his hotel room and just sharing spiritual journey and things like that. And I shared that story with him. And he looked at me, and I said, "You know, gee," I said, "I'm not real sure what the lamb represents, but I've always thought maybe that represents Christ." And he said, "No, Paul, it does not." I said, "You know," I said, "Oh, okay, what is it?" He said, "Let me tell you what that means." And if you've been to Israel and you know Jew, you know that that's exactly how he sounds. He says, "I tell you what it means. Here's what it means." He said, "You are the lamb." I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "You are the little lamb. Jesus is not a little lamb. You are the little lamb, and he has you." He said, "That represents your faith, and he has you. You are his little lamb." And I'm like, "Yeah, I like that. I like that." Now, I've never shared that publicly, not from a pulpit, anyway. And the reason why I share it today is because every one of us in this place, every person you work with, every person you go to school with, every person you encounter has a destiny with their last day. Everyone. I thought that was going to be my last day, but I still have one coming. And God knows when it is. You have a date with that as well. Every time we go to a funeral, every funeral I ever do, I say we all have a date with this day. The question is, are you ready for that day? Now, if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, you're ready. That's what makes you ready. You say, well, what makes you ready? You have to have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, because the Bible is clear. There's only one of two places that you're going to go as a result of that day coming. You'll either spend eternity with God in heaven, or you'll spend eternity separated from him in hell. You say, "Paul, I don't really like to hear that." Well, I understand that. None of us do. But you have a choice. That's the thing. You're not assigned to something that can't be changed. If you're here this morning without Christ, that is, I'll tell you this, if you're here this morning without Christ, that's why God brought you here. I promise you. Because he doesn't want you to leave this room without knowing that you know that you know that you know that you belong to him. John wrote in 1 John, "I write these things that you may know." Here's the good news. God doesn't want you to hope you're saved, wish you're saved, or think you're saved. He wants you to know you're saved. I talk to people and say, "Tell me about your relationship with the Lord. If you were to die today, do you know where you would spend eternity?" "Well, I think I'd go to heaven." You think. Eternity is too long to be wrong. I don't want to think it. Well, I hope so. Oh, no, no. Listen, if you're here this morning and you say, "I think so, I hope so," I got great news. You can know stuff. You don't have to leave here this morning without knowing that you belong to Him. It's the most important decision you can make. So, as believers then, if that's the most important decision that any lost person here can make, those of us who are believers, as we spend time with God, as we get into the presence of God, we are then to take that to a lost world. We are then to take that to people who desperately need Jesus, but don't know Him. I'm convinced most of the world, they just don't even know they need Jesus. And you and I are God's plan A for telling them. Not just me, not just James, or Danny, or Carrie, or Morgan, or our staff. Yeah, we all are the hired guns. That's what we pay y'all for, isn't it, right? No. We're all called to be ministers of reconciliation, ministers of the gospel. And here's the thing. You have people in your life that God has put in your life just for you to tell them about Jesus. You will encounter people that I will never meet, that James will never meet, that Aaron will never meet. You have people in your life, and God has put you in their life for you to tell them about Christ. Because listen, there's going to come a day where they die. And I wonder, now, look, we can't make the decision for people. But we do have a choice whether we tell them or not. And I just wonder, I think of Penn and Teller. You're familiar with Penn and Teller, the comedy act. And I think both of them are atheists. But I think it's Penn who made the statement that while he is an atheist, he said, but if this Jesus is so important to you Christians, why do more of you not tell me about it? Good point. In the book of Acts, chapter 8, we see a situation in which Philip is led to share the gospel with someone. And I want us to look at that passage this morning because out of it, I believe we can glean some marks of a faithful witness. So I want you to turn with me to Acts. We're going to start reading in just a moment from verse 26. But I also want to tell you, before you leave today, I want you to notice beside our children's building, in the grass, this is really neat. We asked them to leave it up from last week. But the children marked off with stakes and ribbons, marked off in the grass, and it's labeled as well for you to see, basically a life-size model of the temple in the Old Testament. And so they've got the temple itself, they've got the inner courts, they've got the Holy of Holies. So before you leave, go over there and see that today. And it was obviously an act. The disciples have been dispersed from Jerusalem. At first they were just worshiping around the temple and witnessing around the temple. And now they've been dispersed. And so here, in verse 26, it says, an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, get up and go south to the road that descends from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is a desert road. So he got up and went, and there was an Ethiopian eunuch, a court official of Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who was in charge of all her treasure, and he had come to Jerusalem to worship. He was what was known as a God-fearer. There were, in that time, non-Jews who worshiped the Jewish God. And they were called God-fearers. Sometimes they would even convert to Judaism, so to speak. He wasn't a Jew by birth. But here we have this court official, this eunuch, this Ethiopian eunuch. He was in the official court of Candace, who was queen of the Ethiopians. He was in charge, verse 27 says, of all her treasure, and he had come to Jerusalem to worship. And he was returning and sitting in his chariot, and he was reading the prophet Isaiah. And then the Spirit said to Philip, go up and join this chariot. Philip ran up and heard him reading Isaiah the prophet and said, understand what you're reading? And he said, well, how could I unless someone guides me? And he invited Philip to come up and sit with him. Now, the passage of Scripture which he was reading was this. He was led as a sheep to slaughter, and as a lamb before its shearer is silent, so he does not open his mouth. In humiliation, his judgment was taken away. Who will relate his generation? For his life is removed from the earth. The eunuch answered Philip and said, please tell me, of whom does the prophet say this, of himself or of someone else? Then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning from the Scripture, he preached Jesus to him. As they went along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, look, water, what prevents me from being baptized? And Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, you may. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And he ordered the chariot to stop. And they both went down into the water, Philip as well as the eunuch, and he baptized them. And when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away, and the eunuch no longer saw him, but went on his way rejoicing. In this passage, I think we see some key marks of a faithful witness. And so this morning, I want to share these with you. How can you and I become more faithful in our witness for the Lord? Can God use you in the lives of your neighbors and your co-workers and your friends to tell them about Jesus? The reality is that the average Christian never shares the gospel. And yet, one of the most wonderful experiences in the Christian life is to see someone come to Christ, for God to use you in that way, where you talk to them about the Lord, and where you can, the Holy Spirit will use you to lead them to a point of decision. But many Christians aren't very confident in that, not very secure in that. It's really another reason I would encourage you to consider coming to the Tuesday night school. Because this semester, we're going to talk about this. We're going to spend 6 weeks just looking at how to have conversations with people. In fact, I think I've got a picture of our book, if you'd like to get it, if you'd like to come and be a part of it. We're going to be reading a book called Tactics by a guy named Gregory Kochel. And in that book, he talks about how to have conversations with people. Because we live in a day and time where people have a lot of, many times they have a lot of animosity toward the things of God, toward the Bible and the things like that. And so that book is going to be an excellent tool to help us have conversations. And so I would encourage you, if you'd like to talk to me about the class, we'd love to have you. But it's going to teach you how to have conversations and ultimately how to tell someone how to be saved. But when you and I look at this passage, I want to point out some characteristics of a faithful witness that I think might be helpful to you. The first thing I want you to see is that Philip was available. Philip was available. When you and I look at verse 26, it says, the angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, get up and go south on the road that descends from Jerusalem to Gaza. The first thing we see with Philip is he's available to the Lord. Verse 27 says, so he got up and went. Your greatest ability is your availability. You say, well, Paul, I've never been to seminary. I don't know how to share. I don't know how to do this. Listen, just be available. God will take what you have, and he will use it. Now, first of all, if you have your own testimony, that's very powerful in and of itself. Because you're coming not as the hired gun, but as the satisfied customer. I'm not the hired salesman. I'm the satisfied customer. So, all right, some of you guys want to check my man card on this one, but I'll risk it. Now, I don't mean to get you in trouble with your wives. It's just me, okay? I love to vacuum. I know, it's crazy. I love to vacuum. And so, years ago, I know, stick with me, have a point. So I got a Kirby vacuum cleaner. I love my Kirby vacuum cleaner. I mean, Chris will tell you. Now, I'll tell you, I'm weird. I just love the vacuum. It's weird. I'll come to your house. Anyway, maybe. Oh, man, I got myself in trouble now. All right, so I have my Kirby. I love my Kirby. And one day, some friends of mine said, Paul, we got a guy who came to our house, and we get this free gift if you let him come to your house for us. I'm like, oh, boy, one of those things. Okay, what is this? He said, he's selling vacuums. I'm like, oh, okay, bring that thing. I got a Kirby. You know, I don't know what what you got, but anyway, so he comes to the house. Well, he's got a rainbow. Now, I've heard about rainbows, but I got a curvy, you know. So he comes in, and I said, I'm going to just tell you right now, you can show me your rainbow, but I got a curvy. He said, all right, fair enough. You know, it's like a square off. It's like dueling, you know. And he said, tell you what, go get your curvy. And we had an area rug. He said, vacuum that rug right there with your curvy. I said, okay. So I go get my curvy, I vacuum the rug. He says, now watch this. He pulls out his rainbow. He fills it up with the water. And you know, see one of those? He vacuums, and then he pulls the water out, and it's dark. Oh, yeah, oh man, I'm buying a rainbow tonight. I said, yeah, you got me on that one, brother. I said, I'll take it. So I bought the rainbow. Still use the rainbow. Love my rainbow. All right? He said, Paul, what's your point besides making it now where I got to clean the house? My point is this. I was a very satisfied customer after that. And have been forever because I have the attachments and stuff. I told you I'm weird. I love doing the whole thing. Everything is going to be clean. You know, it's cool. And then you can use it for like an air freshener and stuff. So it's got multiple uses. And by the way, if you go buy a rainbow as a result of this sermon, I get no kickback. All right? I'm just a satisfied customer. I'm not a salesman. Here's my point. As excited as I am about my rainbow, or you might be about something that you like, how much more should we be excited about telling people about Jesus? And you don't have to know everything. I don't know everything about, you know, when I bought the rainbow, I didn't know everything about the rainbow. I just knew that thing works. That thing gets up dirt. This one couldn't get it up. I like that. And you could see it. And so I'm telling my friends about it. Hey, let me tell you about this rainbow. You ever seen a rainbow? Those things are amazing. You know? And they're like, that's cool and you're weird. Okay? But here's the thing. Oh, that we would be that excited about telling somebody about Jesus. Philip was available to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit says, Philip, go to that chariot. He was available. My question for you and for me, are you available? When you're in the restaurant and the Holy Spirit whispers, go talk to them about Jesus. When you're at work and the Holy Spirit whispers, hey, why don't you sit down and tell them about me? Why don't you sit down with that friend and introduce the conversation about spiritual things and then talk about Jesus? Do we do it? Are we available? We say we're available. We like to think we're available, but are we available? That's where it starts. If you're not available, then God can't use you in that way. But if you're willing to say this morning, Lord, I'm available. Scared to death? Yes, but available. That's the first start. That's the first step. The second thing I want you to see is in verse 27. So he got up and went. That is, when we're available, then we are to be obedient. So when the Holy Spirit speaks to you, then you say, okay. And you go into it. Now, you may be scared to death. You may not have the first clue what you're going to say. But the moment he speaks to you, guess what? He's already got what you need to say. And he'll give it to you. Don't you remember Jesus told his disciples that? Don't worry about what you're going to say. The Holy Spirit will give it to you. And he will. You just be available. And in that moment, you know, it all happens. Pop, pop, pop. Holy Spirit says, why don't you speak to this person? I don't know what to say, Lord. I'll give it to you. Okay, you guide me. And he will. So, you know, we've all had some different experiences like that. I'll tell you very quickly about one that I had that was just a watershed for me in my life. And so, several years back, Kristen's father's pastoring in South Carolina, and he asked me to come. The church I was pastoring was in North Carolina. He said, Paul, would you come with us and do a marriage retreat? We're going to be in Pigeon Forge. We want you to come and do a retreat with us for the weekend. I said, sure, I'd be honored, be glad. That'd be fun. So Kristen and I go, and it's me and Kristen and Phil and Joy. We're in one of the breaks during one of the day, that Saturday, and we've got about 3 hours or so of some free time, and so we go, we're in Pigeon Forge, and we go to get some ice cream, and we're walking kind of in the area, you know, the shopping area, and there's these about five guys, and they're playing hacky sack, you know what that is. And we played hacky sack in high school, and, you know, that was still kind of a thing, and so they're playing hacky sack. I said, oh, man, I haven't seen hacky sack in years. And so I walked over to them, and as I'm walking that way, the Holy Spirit says, why don't you tell them about me? Yeah, but Lord, we're going to get ice cream. finished talking about you. I'm talking about you at this conference. This is now ice cream time. You know. Lord says, no, I want you to talk to those five guys about me. Okay. All right. So as we're walking by, I looked at Chris and said, y'all go on in, I'll be in there in a minute. She said, okay. She kind of knew what was going on, and so I walked over there. I'm looking for an opportunity or some type of connection to talk to these guys, and I just start talking about hacky sack. I said, yeah, I haven't seen hacky sack since I was in high school in the late 80s. We played it, we kicked it around and stuff like that. So we're just kind of talking there, and we get into the conversation about Jesus. It's kind of easy to end somehow. They said, well, what are you doing? I said, here's how it works. You may say, well, how'd you get into the conversation? I said, you guys from here? And they said, yes, we're actually from. I said, okay. I said, I'm from North Carolina. I'm here doing the marriage conference. Oh, okay. And we're at this church. And so I start talking to them. You have a church home in this area? No, I don't either. Okay. I said, would you mind if I share something with you that's really important to me? And they're like, no. So I start sharing Jesus with them. And the Lord said, bring them to a point of decision. That's the hardest part, is it not? You talk to people about Jesus and spiritual things, but then you got to ask the question. So I do it this way. This is a very easy way that I do it. I just say, well, guys, let me ask you something. Do you understand what we talked about today? Yeah, makes sense. Okay. If you understand what we've talked about, would there be any reason why you wouldn't want to receive the Holy Spirit or receive the Lord today? And many times I'll preface that with the question, if you were to die today, do you know where you would spend eternity? They'll say yes or no, and then you kind of have that conversation. And then I said, is there any reason why you wouldn't want to do that today? Four of the five looked at me and said, no reason. I said, so you'd like to be saved today? Yeah. Four of the five. I said, what about you, young man? He said, no, I don't need that stuff. He said, okay. I said, well, here's what we're going to do, guys. I said, we're going to pray right here, all right? And you're not saved by praying a prayer or walking an aisle or signing a card, but prayer is a way that we voice our heart and intentions for the Lord and how you can, the Bible says, as many as received him, to those that they give him the right to call the children of God. So you're going to pray and voice that to the Lord, your intention to receive Christ, repent of your sins, and receive Christ as your Savior and Lord. Does that make sense? Yeah, it makes sense. Okay. We're going to pray right here, okay, because there's people stopping, and we ain't going to worry about all that, because your eternity is more important than any embarrassment we may have. Amen? Yeah, oh, yeah, we got no problem with that. So that we, six of us pray. Four of them receive Christ right there. What was really cool about it was, I say this is cool, when we said amen, I looked at the one who said he didn't need it. I said, yeah, you sure, sir? You don't want Christ? No, I don't need that. Okay. Well, guess what? You have four new Christian friends. I said, so guys, I said, I'm going to be praying for you. I'm going away. You won't see me again, but maybe I get to see you in heaven. I said, guys, stay with me. It doesn't always end like that. That's one of those stories you walk away going, wow, that was cool. But here's the key. Whether they say yes or whether they say no, you must be obedient. I must be obedient. I must be obedient to share the gospel. Philip was obedient. He says he got up and went. Now, in his case, he meets this Ethiopian eunuch. He's a member of Candace's royal court, as we explained a little bit earlier. He'd come to Jerusalem to worship. He's returning home, and he's in his chariot. Now, this kind of is a laid-out situation because he's already got the Bible open. He's already reading Isaiah. And he's got some spiritual questions, so Philip gets to ease right into this, just laid right out for him. And Philip says in verse 30, do you understand what you are reading? And he says, how can I understand unless someone explains it to me? Someone guides me. So he invites Philip up to come and sit with him. Now notice in all of this, if you back up into verse 26. It says the angel of the Lord spoke to Philip. That's in verse 26. And it says in verse 29, then the Spirit said to Philip, go up and join this chariot. So here's another mark I want you to see. The first one is to be available. The second one is to be obedient. But then we also have to be Spirit-led. We have to be led by the Holy Spirit. Because every situation is different. You never know what God's going to do. So another time, and things I can share from my own life that had happened. I was doing a men's conference one time in North Carolina. I had spoken on a Friday night. I had some time to kill, and I felt like the Lord, and this is kind of out of character for me, really, but I felt like the Lord said there was a big, in North Carolina, there's this chain of gas stations called Sheets. They're kind of like Wawa or Racetrack, and they're big and nice and all. And there was one right outside my hotel room, and I just sensed the Lord say, I want you to go tell some people about me down there. Okay. I want to be available. I want to be obedient. I want to be Spirit-led. Let's do it. So I go down there, and I start talking to some people about the Lord. I just, and you know, that kind of flips people out sometimes because it's night. It's a gas station. What's this guy up to? What's he want? And so I walked up to this one young man who was pumping his gas, and I just said, excuse me, sir, is there anything I can pray for you about? He looked at me with big eyes. He said, are you a preacher? I said, well, it just so happens I am. He said, get in the car. I said, hold on. we move real quick here, bro. Let's back up a bit. Because I said, what do you mean get in the car? He goes, my girlfriend's in the car. We've been having this debate. Right? And we asked for a preacher. We just prayed, asked the Lord for a preacher, and here you are, and I want you to settle the debate. I'm like, okay, Lord, you knew this was going to happen. I'm just going to trust you, whatever. So I get in the car, and so we're sitting in the car, and he said, and she looks at me like, who are you? You know, I get in the back seat, and she said, honey, he's a preacher. And she goes, really? I am. And she said, okay, good. We asked for a preacher. So you needed to settle the debate. Here's the situation. We're living together. I say it's sin. He says it's not. I say we need to get married. He says, no, we're good. What do you say? I said, bro, she's right. She's right. He said, really? I said, yeah. I said, come on. We're adults. Let's not play again. She's right. If you are not married, diplomatic here in how I say this. I said, you're red-blooded American male. Come on. You going to honor God or no? And he goes, yes, I knew you were right. I just didn't want to hear it. He said, well, we asked God for you to show up. You showed up. And I'm like, well, let's pray together. I'm getting out of this car. So we prayed. What's really cool about it is that there were another two guys that walked up. Start talking to them about the Lord. They play college basketball. One of them said, I don't need that. I said, well, how about you, buddy? He said, yeah, I'll definitely need that. I need to get saved right here tonight. I need that. I'm going to go to hell if I die. Yeah, I did it. So we pray. And when we finish praying, the other guy looks at me and goes, yeah, I need it too now. I said, what changed your mind? He said, I don't want to go to hell. Here's the thing. I'm not trying to put myself off as some master evangelist, okay? I'm just simply saying, if you'll be available, obedient, and Spirit-led, God will use you with what you have in ways that you just, he'll put you in situations like you will never believe. I never believed I was going to be getting in a car with a couple I didn't know. But yet, God will use these things. He did it with Philip. But I want you to see a fourth thing about Philip. He comes up and he asks him, do you understand what you're reading? And the eunuch says, well, how could I let someone guide me and invite Philip to come up in the chariot? That's what I thought about. I thought, oh, yeah, that's like when the couple invited me into the car. And it says that he's reading to him out of Isaiah, and then he has a question in verse 34. The eunuch says, okay, so tell me, is he talking about himself or is he talking about someone else? Verse 35, then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning from the scripture, he preached Jesus to him. So the fourth characteristic I want you to see was that Philip was Jesus-centered. Because what will happen is when you start talking to people about the Lord, they want to get you into all kind of other peripheral conversations. They want to debate you about evolution, and they want to do this and that. And I'm not saying to a degree, yes, answer some of those questions on a very surfacey basis, okay, because sometimes you have to do pre-evangelism before you can do evangelism. You know, a lot of people have a lot of questions. I'm not saying dismiss the questions, but say, I'll tell you what we'll do. We will talk about that, but let me go here first. We'll come back to that, okay? Because you don't want to get into some big debate over, you know, micro versus macro evolution and all that kind of stuff. What you see here is a great principle for you and I. Philip made a beeline for Jesus. No matter what, he kept bringing it back to Jesus. And people will take you on all kind of little rabbit trails. Now, it may not be apologetics. It may not be some type of debate like evolution. But it may be, well, why did this happen to my grandma? Why did they? You know what? Those are good questions. And what you want to communicate is, I care about you, and I'm not dismissing your question, but let's get back to Jesus and the cross. Make a beeline for the cross. I was on a train years ago going to Alabama. I'm sitting in the food cart. Young man sitting there. We start talking. We start talking about Jesus. He wants to debate everything in the world. Validity of Scripture, Jesus' resurrection, you know, Islam, the whole deal. I said, look, your questions are wonderful. We can sit here all night and talk about them. But at the end of the day, here's where it's going to boil down to, all right? What will you do with Jesus? That's what it's going to boil down to. All these things you're talking about, quite frankly, I think at this point, and I felt like I could say this to him, I said, quite frankly, I think they're your smoke screen because you want to deal with everything but Jesus. Jesus is the question. What will you do with Jesus? Jesus asked his disciples, who do you say that I am? So we have to ask the world, who do you say that he is? And if he is Jesus, if he is the Son of the living God, if he is the resurrected Christ, he deserves our worship, amen? He deserves our lives. He deserves every single thing. So stay focused on Jesus. If you look, as a result of that, he preached Jesus to him. Verse 36 says, they went along the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, hey, look, here's water. What prevents me from being baptized? And Philip said, well, if you believe with all your heart, you may. And he answered, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And so he ordered the chariot to stop, and they both went down to the water, Philip, as well as the eunuch, who was baptizing. What we see here is a fifth principle in that while Philip was available, obedient, and spirit-led, he was also decision-focused. He wanted to bring this man to a point of decision. Now, as you're sharing the gospel with people, we're not called to judge people, but we are called to kind of inspect fruit, so to speak. We are called to kind of discern where are they. Sometimes you and I can make the mistake of pressing too hard. But most of the time, I think we make the mistake of not pressing at all. And so, and it is the hardest part of sharing your faith, is to bring that person, to ask that question, to bring them to a point of decision. And I like to do it like this. I like to say, if you were to die today, do you know where you would spend eternity? Well, I think so, I hope so, or whatever. Okay. Another way of asking that question is, if you were to stand before Jesus today and he would ask, why should I let you into my heaven, what would you say? Most people will say, well, I'm a good person. Okay? And I would say to that, I'll often say, well, based on what? I mean, what do you mean you're a good person? Well, and here's where they always go. I've never killed anybody. I'm like, well, that's good. I mean, most of us haven't, but that's not the only thing to look at. So we talk about what it means to be good. And as in Romans, Paul said, there is no one good, no, not one. So as we deal with them and we talk with them about their sin, we help them to realize that Jesus is the only way. Then I will ask, and I walk them through the gospel, then I will say, is there any reason why today you would not want to be saved? And I'll tell you that, honestly, in my experience, 90% of the time, they say, no, there's no reason. That's okay. So would you be willing today to repent of your sin and receive Christ as your Savior and Lord? Again, 90% of the people I've had conversations with like this, they say yes. You realize that the average person, I'm not just talking about receiving Christ, but even with church attendance, 80% of Americans, in a study I saw, a Lifeway study, 80% of Americans say they would be willing to go to church if someone would just invite them. Can you imagine? Many times they don't come because they've just not been invited. So we need to do the inviting. We need to bring, also as we share the gospel, to bring the person to a point of decision, to ask the question. Well, that's what Philip did. says that in verse 38, he ordered the chariot to stop. They both went down the water, and Philip as well as the eunuch, and he baptized him. When they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip away physically. Can you imagine? I wonder what the eunuch thought about that. I want to ask him that one day. What was that like when you come up out of the water and you look and Philip's gone? In the little time that he had, although he didn't have a lot of time, obviously, but he did get to baptize him, it gives us a sixth and final principle this morning, and that is to be discipleship-oriented. So if Philip was available, obedient, Spirit-led, Jesus-centered, decision-focused, he was also discipleship-oriented. Meaning, at least to the point of baptism, he took him another step. So for you and I, we can apply that in our lives, where when you lead someone to Christ, 9 times out of 10, it's going to be someone that you know. Now, sometimes it will be someone that you've never met. But a lot of times it will be someone that you know. Follow up with them. Get with them. Begin to walk them through some things on how to read the Bible, how to pray. Invite them to church. Spend some time with them. Let God use you in the lives of people. There's only two things that are going to last forever, and that is the Word of God and the souls of men, women, boys, and girls. And Jerry Bridges says, to the extent that you are involved in those two things, you're involved in eternity. I believe, obviously, the greatest joy of heaven is going to be able to see Jesus face to face. Nothing will surpass that. And to worship Him and to sit in His presence. But I'll tell you what I think another joy is going to be. And before I tell you this, I want to challenge you with what I'm about to say to take that and say, today is going to be a new day for me. Lord, I want to be available to share Jesus because of this reason. Two reasons, really. Number one, we don't want them going to hell. But number two, can you imagine the joy that you're going to experience in heaven with someone coming up to you, giving you a hug and saying, thank you. Thank you for telling me about Jesus. I'm here because you shared with me. I'm here because you talked with me. I'm here because you prayed with me. I'm going to tell you, outside of Jesus Himself, I can't think of a greater joy than just to know that someone was there because you took time to talk to them. So if you've heard this message and you say, Paul, I hear you. I see the Bible. I hear what it says. But I'll tell you that I'm scared to death of it. Well, welcome to the club. Because I've been preaching since I was 18, and I'm still scared to death when I do it. Why? Because it's the most important message in the world. I'm not selling rainbow vacuums. That'd be fine. That'd be easy. This is eternity. These are the things of God. So I want to ask you to bow your head this morning. And I'll ask you, first of all, do you know Jesus, ma'am? Do you know Jesus, sir? Do you know that if you die today, do you know where you will spend eternity? Will you please come to Christ? Will you please? I'm pleading with you. I think it was Spurgeon who said, if men and women must go to hell, at least let them do so, leaping over our bodies, trying to drag them away. Something to that effect. So here I am pleading with you, please, please, confess your sins to Christ. Ask Him to be your Savior today. You can do it in your words, right there where you are. Just say, Lord, I confess to you, I am a sinner. And Jesus died for me. And today, right now, I confess all my sins. And I ask you to be my Savior and my Lord. I give you my life. Now, if you have prayed that prayer with me or something to that effect right now, we want to rejoice with you. We're going to have some counselors right up here. In fact, I'll ask them to go ahead and get in place. We've got some counselors here at the front that would love to pray with you. Would you just step out and come to one of them and say, hey, I just prayed that prayer? Because they want to know it. say, can we just all kind of quietly stand up? That way, if folks need to make their way to a counselor, they can. Will you come? Sir, did you just pray that prayer? Ma'am, will you let us know that? So while you're responding, to those of us who know Jesus, would you be willing to pray something like this? Lord, use me. Use me to bring people to Christ. I'm available, Jesus. I don't feel very knowledgeable sometimes, but I'm available. I don't know how good I'll be at it, but I'm available. And here's the thing, you don't have to worry about being good at it. Because if you make yourself available, you can also say, Holy Spirit, use me. Use my story. Use my life. Create some divine appointments for me today so that I can share Jesus. So I can at least get the conversation started. You might not get all the way. Maybe, listen, if everybody in this room were just to walk around just sprinkling the gospel wherever we went, the people of Okeechobee would encounter it all throughout the day from different people. And you might be just a seed planter one day, but the next day he might use you to harvest. So just plant the seeds. Would you be willing to say that, Lord, use me to plant seeds all throughout Okeechobee? Lord, we want to be available. We want to be obedient. We certainly want to be led by your Holy Spirit. And Lord, we want to be Jesus-focused. We want to be decision-oriented. We want to be discipleship-centered. We don't want to just love them and leave them. Lord, we want to see people come to you, and we want to continue to love them as they grow into maturity. So, Lord, here we are. Would you be willing to say that to the Lord? Here I am. Send me. Here I am, Lord. Do with me what you want to. Lord Jesus, there was a time in each of our lives, those of us who know you, that somebody shared with us. It might have been a parent or a grandparent, might have been a pastor or a friend. But Lord, you used that person to bring us to salvation, to transfer us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. And Lord, now we have the privilege of going and telling others. Because Lord, in the time I've spoken, another 250 people have died. And so Lord, help us to be urgent